Good evening, and welcome to tonight's meeting of Inforum, a division of the Commonwealth Club by and for people in their 20s and 30s with a mission to inspire debate on civic issues. You can find us online at commonwealthclub.org/inforum. I'm Doug Sovern, reporter at KCBS Radio and kcbs.com, where you can read my blog, Sovern Nation. Tonight, in same-sex marriage, state versus fed, we will look into the current controversy and federal court case dealing with the passage of California's Proposition 8 in 2008. After numerous protests, lawsuits, and campaigns, tonight we're going to try to answer some of the questions about the future of our Constitution and the future of same-sex marriage licenses. Let's meet tonight's panelists. Molly McKay is the media director of Marriage Equality USA. She's been active in Californians for Same-Sex Marriage and the California Freedom to Marry Coalition. In 2004, she helped organize the Marriage Equality Express, which led to the first national marriage equality rally in Washington, D.C. Jennifer Morse is the president and founder of the Ruth Institute at the National Organization for Marriage, an organization that opposes same-sex marriage. Before joining the Ruth Institute, she was an economics professor at Yale and at George Mason University. Therese Stewart is the chief deputy city attorney for the city and county of San Francisco. She is currently one of the attorneys for the plaintiffs in the federal court case challenging Proposition 8. In 1999, she became the first openly gay president of the Bar Association of San Francisco. And Kevin Snider is the chief counsel for the Pacific Justice Institute. He's been an attorney since 1993. He primarily practices in constitutional law and civil rights. His past cases include the defense of the national motto, "In God We Trust." Please welcome our guests. All right, let's begin with the basic question, because I know a lot of people remain a little bit confused because this issue has been working its way through the courts for 6 years now. It's been through the state court system 3 different times. Why is this now in the federal courts? Let's begin with Terry Stewart. Maybe you could give us a brief explanation of how this got into the federal system now and how this differs from the state cases that came before.
Sure. Thank you, Doug. The first 3 cases that we had preceding this one that touched on these issues, one was against the mayor of the city and county of San Francisco challenging his authority to issue marriage licenses at a time when the statutes on the books in California excluded same-sex couples from marrying. And that case ended up focusing simply on his authority and didn't really resolve the constitutional issues. The second case was really a series of cases brought by both the city and county and couples challenging the exclusion under the state constitution. Very parallel in a lot of ways to the federal case that's pending now, except that it was brought as a state constitutional challenge under the state's equal protection and due process provisions and privacy provisions of its constitution and not the federal. Third case happened after the high court in California, the Supreme Court in California, decided that the laws did discriminate against gay men and lesbians and that excluding same-sex couples from marriage violated the state constitution. The voters passed a proposition known as Proposition 8, which essentially overrode that court decision and made an exception in the California Constitution to equal protection to exclude same-sex couples from marrying. The current case is a federal constitutional challenge under the federal equal protection and due process clauses to Proposition 8. So it both challenges a different law in the sense that a law that was enacted subsequently, but more importantly, it's a challenge that's brought under the federal constitutional equal protection and due process clauses.
Kevin Snider, can I ask you, do you think there is a federal issue here? Should this be in the federal courts?
I don't really think it's proper for the federal courts. Traditionally, marriage has been determined by the states. It's been that way really since the beginning of the founding of the Republic. And there is no federal marriage license. And so, generally speaking, under the 10th Amendment, the states are given police powers. That's usually determined to be health, welfare, safety, education, and morals. Hence, you have a marriage license comes under that rubric. And so, generally speaking, that would not be proper. A challenge perhaps to DOMO could be an exception to that because you have a federal statute, but I don't think it's probably the proper venue for it.
And Terry, you've been arguing, we'll get to our other panelists in a moment, but Terry, you've been arguing for this through every one of these levels, and all 4 of these cases. Do you want to respond to that?
Yes, I mean, I disagree with Kevin, and I think history gives you the answer to that. All state laws, including in areas where the states have traditional sovereign power, are still subject to the requirements of the federal constitution. And that includes marriage. And there have been a number of cases challenging marriage laws, not this particular one, but challenging marriage laws on federal constitutional grounds, in which the U.S. Supreme Court has struck down various marriage-related regulations. The one that people are most familiar with is Loving versus Virginia, which involved a ban on interracial marriage that dated back to the time of the colonies, and that basically every state that had any appreciable number of African Americans had such a ban on its books, and the court struck it down under equal protection. But there have also been cases that struck down state marriage laws that basically treated men and women differently on the grounds that it violated equal protection because it involved gender stereotypes, and cases involving prisoners' right to marry, and cases involving the right to marry of people who are behind on their child support. And in all of those cases, the federal court looked at the Equal Protection Clause and determined that the right to marry is very fundamental, and held that those laws violated the Equal Protection Clause on a number of different grounds, sometimes race discrimination, sometimes gender discrimination, but also just ones that interfered with the right to marry in a way, in the case of prisoners who are not a special class, but that really wasn't justified by a compelling or an important state interest.
Jennifer Morse, maybe you can sum up your organization's position on why same-sex couples, at least in California and also nationally, shouldn't be allowed to marry.
Well, this is a little different from the constitutional-level arguments that we're making here, but as a matter of public policy, the National Organization for Marriage, as well as the Ruth Institute, we believe that marriage is properly between one man and one woman because the natural and indeed essential purposes of marriage have to do with gender. And in particular, what I mean is that the essential purpose of marriage is to attach mothers and fathers to their children and to one another. And I mean that as an essential purpose in this sense. If you didn't need to do that job, you wouldn't need marriage in the first place. In other words, the fact that we are born through sexual reproduction with one mother and one father, the fact that children are helpless and dependent for long periods of time, these are the basic facts about the human experience that have prompted every known society to come up with something like marriage, to attach the parents to the children and to one another for the good of the children and for the good of the whole society. And so if you didn't have that need, there wouldn't be any purpose to marriage. Marriage would be something quite different. It'd be a subset of friendship somehow, and it wouldn't have the same kind of social significance that it has. And so, therefore, we think that gender is absolutely essential to marriage, and that really what is happening, it's not that we're opening up marriage to include people who are excluded. In fact, what we're doing is we're redefining marriage. Instead of marriage being the union of one man and one woman, marriage will become the union of any two persons, and that will fundamentally change what marriage is all about in ways that we think will be destructive. And also, I think it should be said that the needs that same-sex couples have, the practical problems, we think can be met through other provisions other than by redefining marriage. So that would be the basic position.
I know there are people here who want to respond to that, but let me just echo Judge Vaughn Walker in the case that's still going on now in San Francisco. One of the questions he asked the attorneys was, does one need to be married to procreate? And the answer is no, you don't need to be married to procreate. So how does that jive with the argument that...
Well, you don't need to be married to procreate, but the fact is that there's a great social good to being married and procreating, that linking sexual activity, procreation, and childbearing and spousal love under the category of marriage is a great social good because it protects the interests of the children that are born. And the children's interests, let's you know, look at it from the child's point of view for a moment, that we think that children are entitled or have a legitimate interest in having a relationship with both of their parents, both of the people that brought them into being. And the idea of marriage, the essential idea of marriage in all times and places that we know of, is to protect that entitlement that children have. And so the fact that for the last 30 or 40 years we've thrown that out the window and said we don't care about that anymore, I don't think that's decisive, because in point of fact, we've done a lot of harm to a lot of children by throwing out that requirement. And I think I would like to see us take that more seriously.
Molly McKay with Marriage Equality USA, scribbling furiously, ready to weigh in. How would you respond to some of that?
Well, certainly biology and demographics have never been guaranteed to provide a good and loving home for the children. And 30 years of social science, as we just saw in the federal court case, prove that same-sex couples raise children currently and are wonderful parents. The children are, you know, not harmed, and there is no facts to support the kind of arguments that Jennifer's making. I think it's intriguing also, you know, people are foster parents, they're adopted parents, and when people, what's most important for children is to be raised in a loving, stable household where they are, their needs are important, they are prioritized, and that's exactly what same-sex couples do. Providing marriage equality, providing them the protections and the security that come with those rights and obligations for their parents is essential to their well-being. And certainly, if you talk to children of same-sex couples, they will tell you that it's very important to them that their parents be able to be married because they want to have the safety, the security, and the stability that everyone else has and that they deserve.
Now, it's interesting because there are emotional arguments, there are legal arguments, constitutional issues here, but in the court case that's been going on, they all sort of get woven together. And Therese Stewart, I know, and Jennifer Morse, you just summed up essentially the defendant's central argument that marriage is first and foremost about procreation and attaching the parents to the child, which becomes their argument in the constitutional case. Therese Stewart, you had some response to what Ms. Morse was telling us?
Well, yes, a number of things. One is that we've never limited marriage to people who were likely to or inclined to procreate. So there are many, many heterosexuals who marry in their old age or marry without the desire or the intent or the capability of having children. And marriage serves some really important government interests besides supporting children. Although I don't disagree with Jennifer, I agree with her that supporting children is an important purpose. But creating stable relationships between a couple alone is an important government interest because it creates a safe haven. It makes for people who have an obligation of support to each other and lessens the likelihood that the individuals in a couple will then fall on the government for support. It creates higher productivity because people in families are happier. And there's a lot of social science evidence by social scientists who weren't really focused on this issue in particular that marriage creates health benefits and productivity benefits for the couple involved. But with regard to children, Molly alluded to the social science evidence. Every major science organization, the American Psychological Association, American Psychiatric Association, the National Association of Social Workers, the National Association of Child Welfare, every one of those social science organizations, based on the 30 years of research that have now been done, have concluded decisively that same-sex couples raise children who are just as well adjusted and who suffer no negative consequences by being raised by gay men and lesbians. And so the idea that the only environment that the state should encourage to be a stable one for children is one that's an opposite sex couple just isn't borne out by the social science literature. You know, the idea, too, that you need a mother and a father is an interesting one, and I do think that Jennifer's right that some people believe that, and they are certainly entitled to that belief. But there's nothing in California's law and in most states' laws anymore governing marriage that's gender-based. There's nothing that says mothers have to perform this role, fathers have to perform that role. Why? Because people are different, and various kinds of various women do different things, and some of them are the disciplinarians, some of them are nurturing, and fathers, it's the same thing. So the idea, you can have your marriage and you can live your marriage the way that suits you and your spouse, but it doesn't mean that we dictate that. And I think heterosexual people, if we told them they had to perform certain gender roles because one was a woman and one was a man in parenting or in their spousal relationship, there'd be an uproar, and it would be a big one. In fact, it was. It happened in the 70s, and that's why we have some of the cases I mentioned earlier.
Well, no one's saying that the state is supposed to dictate parental roles or gender roles. Nobody's saying anything remotely like that. What we're saying is that children, as a matter of fact, have two parents, one man and one woman, and that for the child to be deliberately deprived of a relationship with one of those people by the conspiracy of the parents of one of the parents and the state, that there's something wrong with that, and that that's not something that ought to be encouraged. Let me respond to this point about the social science evidence. In fact, there there is a history of this social science literature, but there isn't really that much, actually. There have actually been more reviews of the studies than there have been studies themselves, because everybody wants to read those 30 studies themselves and come to their own conclusions about them. And I think the most honest thing to say about those studies is that they really are not decisive, in the sense that they don't say... There are a variety of problems with the studies, the most basic one being that they're not random samples. Usually they're convenient samples. That is, we don't have enough same-sex couples raising children to get a genuinely random sample of people that would really be scientifically valid. So that's one problem. And also, we don't have the long-term studies that we would like to have, and we don't have all the indicators that we would like to have. So I think it's fair to say that there's a whole body of other material that should be brought to the table, that's valid to bring to the table. And let me mention just a couple of things. First of all, we know from a lot of social science evidence that step families function quite differently from biological families. Now, what we don't know is how that will play out in a same-sex couple, because a same-sex couple has some things in common with a bio family. That is, perhaps both of the parents were there from the very beginning of the child's existence, and so in that sense, they're more like a bio couple. But they're more like a step couple in the sense that one is the biological parent and one is not. And what we don't know long term is how that's going to pan out. But we know for sure that step families behave quite a bit differently than families where both of the parents are the biological parents who are married to one another. So the claim that Molly made earlier is a little bit misleading in the following way. Step parents get together because they love one another. Right, and so they love each other and they do their best to love the child. But the fact that the husband and wife love one another seems not to be sufficient to make it so it's good enough for the kids, that you get the same kind of outcome for the kids. And that's because there can be tensions inside the household, that this is my child, and you don't really understand my child because it's not really your child. And are those issues going to come up in same-sex couples? Well, probably in some cases. They do.
Jennifer, aren't you a foster parent?
I have been a foster parent. I am an adoptive parent.
Do you love your children just same?
That's not the issue, Molly.
Well, that isn't the issue. You're talking about a situation that you're not even living in yourself. And we're also getting far afield from marriage equality, which is nothing to do with whether same-sex couples can have children or not have children. That argument's over, and we have children. That's the reality. So it's what are we going to do in terms of promoting the stability, if we're on the topic of providing stability and best interests of the children, it's to have their parents be able to be married and to not have the stigma that's attached to gay people currently by allowing for legal discrimination to get written into our state constitution as an exception to the Equal Protection Clause that will not stand. It undermines the notion of our common humanity as human beings. And what is exciting is that our generation has the honor and obligation to be the generation that sees this piece of civil rights legacy in America true to fruition. We need to expand civil rights for all people. All people deserve equal rights. All people deserve to have their basic constitutional protections in place. And the conversation that we're having really isn't even about ending sexual orientation discrimination in the provision of a civil marriage license, which is what is at issue in Proposition 8, which is at issue at the federal court level.
I think the issue is, if there is something that is significantly different, does it make sense, in fact, to have different legal institutions for situations that are, in fact, significantly different? That, I think, is the issue. And so, to me, what we're talking about here is that when a man and a woman are married to one another, the children that they have, the marriage attaches the children to both of those people with what is called the presumption of paternity, which I'm sure you're all aware of. The husband is presumed to be the father of any children born to the woman over the life of the marriage. What we're trying to do here, what is going to happen here, is we're sliding into a presumption of parenthood to take the place of the presumption of paternity, which we know in 100% of the cases of same-sex couples is not true. It is not true that person is, in fact, the parent of that child. What has to happen to make the parent, to make the partner into the parent of the child, is that the parental rights of the other biological parent have to be removed or detached somehow, and then they have to be reattached to that, to the spouse or to the partner. And those steps, it seems to me, are significant and important and deserve to be taken seriously, because that third party, that other parent, that person deserves some consideration.
So, Jennifer, and should heterosexual couples who decide to become foster parents get some other type of license other than a civil marriage license, since they don't have the biological connection to one another, to their child, or should adopted parents not be able, heterosexuals not be able to get civilly married? I mean, it doesn't make any sense.
No, it does make sense, because you're confusing what the institution of marriage is principally for. And if we redefine marriage, we're going to be saying that the biological connection between children and parents is not as important. We're undermining the principle that biology is the principal way, not the only way, but the principal way that we attach parents to children. Adoption exists as an exception, a significant exception, there's no doubt, but it doesn't undermine the basic principle that biology is how we do it. And let me just say, as both a biological parent and an adoptive parent, I have to say, I felt like a second-class citizen when I went to become an adoptive parent. And why did I feel that way? Because I had to get fingerprinted. I had to be investigated. I had to have a home study. I had to have all this stuff done to me that biological parents don't have to have done to them. Okay? Now, why did that make me a second-class citizen? Well, I felt like it at the time, but is that really what it's about? Well, no. What it's about is it's about the state saying and the whole society saying that taking a child from their biological parents and giving them to somebody else is a big deal, and we're going to take it seriously. That's the point. Okay, and what I believe is happening, if we make this slide from a presumption of paternity to presumption of parentage, is we're no longer taking those steps as seriously as they deserve to be taken. It's not just the children of same-sex couples that I'm concerned about, Molly. That redefining marriage redefines it for everybody. And so this new understanding of parenthood that we're in fact putting into place into law is going to have ripple effects throughout the society, affecting far more people than just the handful of people who are in same-sex unions and who have children, which is not that many people.
I want to explore that issue in a moment, actually, but just want to remind our audience that you're listening to the Commonwealth Club's In Forum program on same-sex marriage, state versus fed, and we'll get back to that eventually. But let's give Therese Stewart a chance here to respond, and then I have a question for Kevin Snider. But Stewart.
Well, I'd like to go back to the social science evidence, because I think that it's very telling that the other side in the case did not put on anyone with any kind of social science degree or social science expertise. And the reason is because the studies show that the things that make for good parenting have nothing to do with biology. They have to do with the quality of the relationship of the child to the parents, the quality of the relationship between the parents, the lack of conflict in a marriage. And so the idea that biology is somehow this trumping force, that marriage is only and primarily about the assumption that you're a better parent if you're biologically connected to your kid, or that you'll be a better parent, just isn't borne out by the social science data. It's also not the case that California law in any way reflects that idea. The presumption of parenthood, of paternity that Jennifer referred to is actually true. Under California law, if you're married to someone, you are presumed to be the father of the child if it's a heterosexual marriage, and you're the father to the woman who bears the child if you're married to her. But that presumption has already been held, even outside the context of marriage, to apply to same-sex couples. The court held that the presumed parenthood statutes apply in domestic partnerships. So the same-sex parent of a child is the presumed parent of that child born to her spouse adopted also, so that parents of same-sex couples are treated the same. Basically, in order to adopt the kind of what Jennifer's really saying is that same-sex couples shouldn't have children because they can't have children without with both of them being the biological parents of the child, and that's somehow wrong in the case of same-sex couples, even though it's not wrong that we allow artificial insemination and other reproductive techniques for heterosexual couples. Adoption is perfectly permissible for heterosexual couples. There are lots of ways in which parents, heterosexual and same-sex couples, have children in the world and raise children. Nothing in that does the social science indicate is preferable about having biological children versus non-biological. It's the quality of the parenting, the quality of the relationships that matters. So the single, and I would note that, and I think Molly alluded to this, we haven't seen a lot of ballot initiatives trying to take marriage away from straight couples who can't have kids, or from straight couples who are, where one person is maybe been convicted of some violent felony, or any other situation that involves something that somebody thinks isn't quite right for the kids. So this notion of trying to find something that differentiates same-sex couples from heterosexual couples is, I think, what this biological parenting notion is really about. It's certainly not about valid social science data about what makes for a good environment for children.
Kevin Snider, you had something you wanted to add first.
Well, there is a fundamental flaw in the premises here that we need to get to and step back. And it's a fundamental flaw is that do we create rights through social science studies? And put in another way, should courts be in a position where they're deciding public policy through examining social science? Under our system of government, that has to be done through the legislature. The people, in this instance, were the legislature. I will predict for you that however Judge Walker rules, as this case works its way into the appellate courts, one criticism that will be leveled at him by opinions in the appellate court levels, possibly even in the Supreme Court if they take this up, is that you have a facial challenge to a statute, and you don't bring in social science to determine whether or not something is constitutional. You look at the face of the document. And that is a fundamental flaw. That is an error of law, and that is an error that will be opined upon in the courts. Now,
see, Kevin, I have to totally disagree with you, because under the U.S. Constitution, what it says is that all people will be treated equally. And what Proposition 8 was an exception to the Equal Protection Clause of our state constitution. It literally is an exception. Section 7.0 is Equal Protection Clause, 7.5 is Proposition 8, which literally writes an exception to the rule. All people are treated equally except gay people, and it's unacceptable. And the U.S. Constitution holds that all people are treated equally, and that is why it is a constitutional issue. We don't just vote willy-nilly for every rights, and there are some basic, fundamental human right protections that are written into our founding documents for a reason, so that people can't, by a simple majority vote, strip a certain group of people who have historically been discriminated against based upon no bias and based upon no reason and no purpose, which is why the social science is in there, to show you there's no purpose, there's no reason other than bias aimed at gay and lesbian people, to allow this to stand, and it's unconstitutional to the core.
Now, look at the point. The point is that equality is not a word that can stand alone. Let's get the concepts right. I'm a non-lawyer. I just have to say for the record, I'm the only non-lawyer on this panel, okay? So just let's be logical for a moment. Equality is not a standalone word. You have to ask who is equal to whom and for what purpose. And that's what this whole thing is about. Does it make sense to say that marriage is something that that has nothing to do with gender? Or marriage is something that should be based on one man and one woman? And so you're sitting here telling us that all sorts of things that same-sex couples already want to do, they already have the rights to do them, so what's the point of redefining marriage?
Protecting the children, protecting the couple, and accessing the same rights and benefits that we all pay taxes to, so our government treats us equally that reason.
Molly, you've made my point for me. When you took up the argument in the response, you began a discussion of the Constitution, of the Equal Protection Clause. Not social science. And that's what I'm suggesting, is that that's the fundamental problem with Judge Walker, is he's taking case comes on a statutory challenge, then you look at the face of the language and you determine whether or not it is consistent with the Constitution. You don't bring in a bunch of social science.
Well, Kevin, let me jump in there, and I don't want to cut you off, but I do think social science is quite relevant. I think if you read constitutional cases historically, Brown versus Board is one of our most famous ones, and social science played a very important role there. Now, I know there are some people who still criticize the U.S. Supreme Court for making that decision, but I think, you know, we all remember the story of the psychological evidence comments about the stigma that attached to children who were African American because of their segregation, and who, when they were presented with a white doll and a black doll, basically said the white doll was better. That was social science evidence. There are many constitutional cases in which, when you're looking at the justification for a law, and the justification is often at issue in constitutional cases, then it may be under a rational basis standard that a court isn't going to consider social science evidence. But it certainly, if it's anything higher than that standard, and that's an issue in itself to be determined in this case, the court is perfectly free, and it should look at social science evidence. Otherwise, we're basing this on people's beliefs. You'll hear a lot about people believe, people view things this way, some people think, but the question is, when is it legitimate? What's the justification for treating a group of people differently? And I would suggest to you that people's beliefs are not good enough. There has to be some really good social policy reason. And that depends on social science evidence. And courts do use it in constitutional cases over and over.
And the problem with Brown is not the result of the decision. The problem is they could have looked at the face of the policies, the school policies, and looked at the Equal Protection Clause and don't come up with the same conclusion. The problem is they've opened a Pandora's box so that judges sit in a legislative position to determine public policy by looking at social science. That is fundamentally flawed, and that is we believe that I mark my words. Judge Walker will be criticized soundly for this in the appellate courts for this.
Well, I think Plessy is a really good example of what you do when you don't have social science evidence. Plessy versus Ferguson, which basically said segregation was perfectly legal, looked at the question of stigma with no evidence in front of it. And what did it say? It said, well, if black people feel stigmatized by segregation, that's just their imagination. And it speculated based on judges' beliefs, not on social science evidence. Brown was a more evolved decision because the court looked at evidence vetted through the process of a trial with cross-examination, the ability of both sides to present evidence, a much more thoughtful, much less activist way of doing things than the judges just pulling out their personal beliefs. So I think social science evidence anchors the decision in something legitimate as opposed to leaving the courts and the judges free to vote their own beliefs. That's something the court should not do.
You're setting up the judiciary as a super legislature. We don't want to have the judiciary usurping the powers of the legislative branches, which in this instance was the people. They are disenfranchising the voters.
They have to make constitutional decisions in some manner, and the question is how
they can do that without looking at social science evidence. They could look at a facial challenge, and that was what was brought. And so that was
Plessy.
That is, you don't take, when you go to a court and you want look at a contract, you look at the face of it. And so this is just a preposterous notion. And again, this is going to cause significant problems, I believe, in the future as we allow social science to be brought in into these issues. That social science is proper if this is before a legislative body. But it's not proper before the judiciary.
It is proper to show that there's absolutely no rational basis whatsoever.
There is a rational basis.
For holding a distinction and excluding gay and lesbian people from the institution of civil marriage. There is no rational basis. The court proved it. There was no evidence presented to the contrary. And hopefully it begins to educate the American public as well. There was an opportunity. The case, the evidence was put forward. All kinds of the evidence was overwhelmingly, all the social science, all of the scholars talked about this is based upon bias and harm. It harms real people. There is no justification for it other than bias and intolerance and bigotry.
Jennifer Morse, I'd like to ask you a question, if I may.
Okay, go ahead.
You mentioned earlier, you said that if marriage is redefined, it redefines it for everybody. Same-sex marriage was legal for 5 months in California. There are 18,000 couples out there who are married, who got to stay married legally. How has the state been affected or harmed from that period of time when people were married and having those 18,000 couples there?
Well, I think, with all due respect, no one on our side expects enormous harms to happen in 5 months. What we're looking at is a basic reshaping of the institutions of society, and how's that going to play out over 5, 10, 15, 20 years, over a generation or two, what is our society going to look like? when we have put into place the idea that marriage is simply the union of any two persons and not the union of a man and a woman, when we've said that procreation through artificial means is equal and open to everyone for any reason, whether they're in fact sterile or not sterile, when we've downgraded biology as the basic principle of how we determine parentage, when we've changed so many aspects of the incentive structure that we put into place for people, we don't know how this is all going to pan out, and it's not all going to shake out in 5 months, you know. So that doesn't bother me at all, you know. I mean, because we're looking down the road a little bit further, and you know, we've said a lot about the historical precedent of and the comparisons with race. I think there's a different historical comparison I'd like to put on the table for people to consider, and that is that up until 1968, divorce could only be obtained for cause in basically all the states in the union, and one by one, states, starting with California, eliminated the fault basis for divorce. And the reason they did it is very interesting, how they did it and why they did it. They did it basically, it looks like, from the record, it looks like they did it for the convenience of the matrimonial bar. And the basic argument was that the state has no interest in keeping together people in loveless marriages. And so let's eliminate the fault basis for divorce because it will make it cheaper for people to get divorced who are going to get divorced in any case, and why should we go through all this hassle? And besides, we have some studies that show that the children will be fine as long as their parents are happy. Well, now, it turned out that everything about those forecasts turned out to be false. That is, it wasn't just the behavior of the handful of people who would have gotten divorced in any case. Behavior of everybody has changed as a result of changing the divorce rules. And children have been harmed by divorce. And most of all, the children who have been harmed by divorce are children in low-conflict marriages whose parents formerly would have stayed married and who now no longer do. And so I think that this is this is an example that is worth thinking about, that is worth looking at when we talk about redefining the basic structure under which people decide whether they're going to get married or not, or how they're going to get married. You can have far-reaching ramifications that will take a while to shake out and reveal themselves. And I think with divorce, I think everybody who has studied the impact, the social science evidence on the impact of changing the divorce rules, everybody agrees that this has been a disaster for children. And it has had many effects, not just on marriage itself, but on how people invest, on how people educate themselves, and a whole range of other things. So I think we have to take a much broader view of this matter. And it's marriage that I think this issue is about marriage. I don't think it's principally about discrimination, and if I may be so bold as to speak for the people who voted in favor of Proposition 8, there were 7 million of them after all, most of them were not thinking about, how can we stick it to gays and lesbians? For most of them, they were not thinking about gays and lesbians. It was not about gay people. It was about marriage. What do we think marriage is about? And that was the issue for people, and I think that's worth bringing front and center here.
I have 2 points I want to make. One is a disagreement, now not about social science, but about history. And I think there was actually testimony at the trial, and I believe it was Nancy Cott, that this concept, this idea that's been promoted by our opponents, that no-fault divorce has been, you know, the cause of this rising divorce rate, is actually not accurate. The history shows that the divorce rate, basically from the time our country was founded, has been on an upward trajectory, and the trajectory didn't change because of no-fault divorce. To be sure, it's gone up over time. I think very recently it's begun to level off somewhat, but there was no dramatic upward shift in the curve because of no-fault divorce. So
the
I think that's just
social,
a
the best
a falsity.
Of social science evidence is that it was about 10 percentage points, which is pretty significant.
Well, that's not what Nancy Cott said, and she's written a good number of books on the history of marriage. But in any event, the other thing I want to point out is Jennifer says most people were not thinking about gay people when they voted on Prop 8. They were thinking about marriage. Let me disagree, and I'll tell you what. The best source of information about how the campaign was handled and what the messages were is the campaign consultants themselves, and they were gracious enough to write a wonderful article about how terrific their campaign was. And what they said was, if we focused on the importance of traditional marriage alone, we would have lost the election. We had to convince people there were consequences. And what was the primary consequence that they focused, that they said got the most resonance, and that Ron Prentice, who was the head of the Prop 8 campaign said, turn people around. It was the campaign about your children. You have to protect your children. Well, protect your children from what? Protect your children from exposure to the idea that same-sex marriage is okay, that it's equal, that it's the same, that same-sex unions are okay. Protect your children from exposure to homosexuals. Protect your children from exposure to the idea of homosexuality. It drew on prejudices and stereotypes that go all the way back to our friend Anita Bryant in the 1970s, who ran a very, very similarly messaged, if more expressly hostile, campaign. Protect Your Children. It was called the Save Our Children campaign, and it was all about how the gay people, it's fine for them to have their private relationships, but they shouldn't flaunt it. We don't want to make it normal. And I think in Jennifer's own writing, she talks about one of the problems with same-sex marriages, it will take the stigma away from same-sex relationships and promote them among children. And in fact, that some straight people will be even inclined to enter into same-sex relationships, because mostly women, because men are kind of a pain in the butt. And I'm paraphrasing. Those were not her words.
On that, I think our entire panel would agree, but okay.
But by and large, the message is that there's something really horribly wrong with same-sex relationships, and therefore with the people who are, I think also in her words, afflicted with same-sex attraction. So there's a very strong messaging that was going on in that campaign. And if the campaign had just been, traditional marriage is important, support traditional marriage, it wouldn't have won, and it's the campaign consultants who ran it have admitted that. They tout that, and they tout the fact that their own messaging about consequences, and particularly about children, was what made the day in the campaign. If you need to protect children, you need to protect them from something, and you don't usually protect children from something that's good.
Before you answer, I just want to alert our audience here that we're going to take questions from you in the audience. If you have any, you can begin lining up at that microphone. In about 5 minutes, we will be happy to let you pose your questions to our panel. And remember, it's a question, not a statement, not an argument. So if you have a question to ask, we would appreciate hearing from you. And now, Jennifer Morse.
Yes, the article, I'm glad you brought that one article up, that the point that I was making was not that women are going to become gay. Okay, that was not the point. My point was that there will be women who will decide, all things considered, that it is easier to do parallel parenting with a buddy, with a friend, with a girlfriend, rather than to and get themselves artificially inseminated, rather than put up with a man. These are the kinds of incentives we're putting into place. There's nothing to stop it. There's nothing to change. We're unhinging the basic structure of marriage here. And we don't know everything that people are going to do, but I suggest to you that there are going to be people who are going to do that.
But what's stopping them from doing that now?
Well, because same-sex marriage is not legal.
But why can't a woman decide to have a baby on her own and have her friend help her? I mean,
but
they can do that.
There's a difference between things which are legal and things which are being encouraged by the culture, okay? And right now, I think it's safe to say that most people still think there should be a husband and wife and a man and a woman, okay? And so we're being presented with these arguments on the basis that people with same-sex attraction have no choice about their behavior. And so we're trying to protect them because they are in this this situation where they're being discriminated against and the institutions of society disfavor them. But if you turn around and other people who do not have same-sex attraction, if other people's behavior is changing in addition to theirs, then you're doing something bigger and more significant than just offering protections to same-sex couples. That's the point. And this is a much bigger topic than I think you guys are allowing for. And that's really what I'm trying to say here. I'm not saying people are going to become lesbians. They don't have to be. I'm saying marriage itself will no longer intrinsically be a sexual relationship. You don't have to be in a sexual relationship. You just, okay, we're going to call ourselves marriage. Now, it's true, people do this. They do it for green cards. They do it for all kinds of reasons. People do something that would be regarded as marriage fraud. But we're changing the terms under which people are making these decisions in relationships, and I think that's significant. And I think it's significant for people to be saying, we don't want to go there. We think we can protect the children of same-sex couples without going there. And by the way, I think it's very interesting that you, Molly, on the one hand, you're telling us that the social science literature says that the children of same-sex couples are just fine, they're wonderful, everything's great for them, but they're suffering because they're being stigmatized and their parents are stigmatized, and it would be so much better for them if we got rid of that. Well, so then what's going to happen? Are they going to be super children after we have same-sex marriage?
No, they'll be in families that are treated equally under the law.
Kevin, you had a comment. I believe.
Well, I mean, it's does come down to this, as far as there is a fundamental belief pro same-sex marriage side, and that this is an immutable characteristic. And that's not universally a position held in the gay community, if you look at the gay literature. It's a view that believes in sexual determinism versus sexual autonomy. And it's sort of like going back to your philosophy 101 class, determinism versus free will. And again, this is not a view that is held universally by gay scholars, and that's why I find that it's a little disingenuous for the side to claim that it's absolutely an immutable characteristic. They're confusing homosexuality with homogeneous. They're assuming that there's one reason for the phenomenon of homosexuality. Maybe many reasons for that. And so I find that the reason they have put forward this position is for political and legal reasons. If they could say it's an immutable characteristic, then they get a foot up in court cases.
You know, I want to remind our radio audience this is the Commonwealth Club's Inforum program. We're hosting tonight's program, Same-Sex Marriage, State versus Fed, and we may get an opportunity for you to respond to that, but I want to go to the audience, and let's see. We have quite a few people who have questions. Let's see what's on their mind. Sir, your question for anyone in particular on the panel?
Actually, the question is for Mr. Kevin Snider and Jennifer Morse. First of all, for your own information, I am gay, and it's not my choice. It's just the way I am. And about the children, I want to talk about me when I was a little kid. And then I'm going to ask you a question on how your statement, your position is going to protect me. Okay? I looked at the ads of probate of the little girl, say they wanted to go home and marry a princess. When I was a little kid, I wanted to marry a prince. But society didn't allow me. And I lived a childhood very sad and introvert because I couldn't be myself. So your position is hurting children. And I want to know what you think about that. Thank you.
I think for one thing, your fundamental premise is that the purpose of marriage is for personal satisfaction, for self-gratification. And
to marry who I love.
That's again, it's a narcissistic position. Okay. It's a position that's based on your own happiness. Our position is that marriage should be based on public policy, not private interests.
Jennifer, he asked you the same question. Did you want to respond?
First of all, let me say that I'm sorry for the sadness that you experienced as a child. And I think that
it's your position. Sir, you asked your question. Let's let them answer.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm sorry for the sadness that you experienced as a child, and I think that when we are looking at how we're going to approach the issue of sexual orientation with children, I think that it's part of what is happening to us is that we're thinking that in order to support children in your situation, that what we need to do is to talk to all children about sexuality all the time, almost. And so the thing that was objectionable some of the gay-friendly school curriculum that have been developed in Massachusetts and in other places is that a lot of the conversation about sexuality was much more sexualized at an earlier age than a lot of parents are really comfortable with having their kids. And there's no opt-out provision for a lot of these programs. So what we want to do to help the minority of children who have same-sex attraction and who need some special support, what we do for those children, I think, is quite different from what we're going to do for all children generally. And I think your quarrel here is with the fact that you are out of the ordinary, that you are unusual, and I'm not sure how
I'm
we're
normal.
Going to,
huh? I'm normal. I may not be the norm, but sir,
normal. Sir.
But
no one can hear you if you're off the mic, and question.
Okay.
We want to give other people opportunities as well.
Let me just mention one thing, and that's Quebec. The government of Quebec has come out with a policy against homophobia, and in that policy, what they are saying is that they believe it's the job of the state to eliminate heterosexism, to eliminate the view that heterosexuality is normal. That is the role that the government of Quebec has taken on for itself. And I think they think they're doing that for you. I think that's what they think. And I think that for the state to take on a job of that kind is to completely take over the functions of civil society and to put itself into the middle of civil society in a way that is completely overbearing and is really not appropriate. And I think that is what... It's not that that the voters of Proposition 8 don't ever want their children to see a homosexual or anything like that. It's that they want to determine the time and place that their kids are taught about these things.
We want to
get to some
more questions, but Terry Stewart, I'll give you a minute. I think you have some things you want to respond.
I just need to respond to this idea that that parents need to be able to determine when their children will be exposed to the idea of homosexuality because basically it's somehow a sexual discussion. We have fairy tales all the time about princesses who grow up to marry princes, and by the way, live happily ever after, narcissistic as that may be. And we present that to children all the time without quarrel, without concern, without considering it adult material. And yet, when we have a book that talks about a prince who grows up and is pushed by his mom to marry a princess and falls in love with a prince and marries the prince, no sex in it, unless you consider a kiss inside a heart to be sex, which I think I've seen equivalent things in Snow White and stuff like that, it's not sexualized. And what is really going on here is a continued effort to erase and keep invisible same-sex people who are gay and lesbian and their relationships from children. Not their sex life. Nobody's talking about sex ed. They're talking about just people's dreams. Children like Bill's partner who just spoke about, you know, thinking about what am I going to be when I grow up and not having anything presented that fits who you think you are. And I don't think there's anything about that that's about sex. And this obsession with sex as though it's the only thing that defines homosexual people is itself a form, I think, of animus.
Sir, your question for someone on the panel?
Sure. This question is for Jennifer Morse. I know who you are, so I'd like you to know a little bit about me. I'm a gay Republican. My husband and I were married in California on October 12, 2008, 1 month before the passage of Proposition 8. Both my Catholic parents and my Mormon in-laws are incredibly supportive of our marriage. My question of you is, the National Organization for Marriage and other opponents of same-sex marriage vehemently deny that their opposition is based on bigotry and hatred. And my question for you is, isn't this belied by the National Organization for Marriage's own advertisements, which describe me and my gay and lesbian brothers and sisters as a gathering storm?
Sir, I think the gathering storm is about the increased power of the state that is going to be required to not simply accept gay and lesbian people, but to normalize gay and lesbian people, to make it feel and seem as though heterosexuality versus homosexuality is simply a coin toss. And I just don't see how you can suppress the ordinary impulses that the vast majority of people feel, which is for persons of the opposite sex. That is what society will be built around, and I think that you can have a society that's accepting of gay and lesbian persons without saying that it's quote-unquote normal, or making it normalized, or making it seem like it's a coin toss. And so I don't think that's animus. I think that's closer to common sense.
Being gay is no different than being right-handed or left-handed. People should be not treated differently than we treat right-handed people and left-handed people, because the social science does, and the American Psychiatric Association, the American Psychological Association, et cetera, has already determined, and the issue is over, that gay and lesbian people are equal in all ways, shapes, and forms. We may be a smaller part of the biological world, but we exist in every country, over all time, we exist. It's no different than being right-handed or left-handed, and we should treat people who are gay and lesbian people versus straight people as no different than if they are right-handed or left-handed. There's plenty of space in this big world that we live in to love each other, to see past differences, to treat children that, you know what, people may be a little different, but everyone should be treated equally. And it's not okay to take away people's civil rights because they're a little different from you, which was the lesson that children took away from Prop 8.
Sir, you have a question for someone on the panel?
Yes, I'd like to know whether Jennifer's organization supports the rollback of domestic partnership and civil union laws, since in many states like California, they offer pretty much the same benefits and responsibilities as marriage does. They just don't have the same name. And if you do not support the rollback, do you oppose their extension at the federal level so that the United States government would recognize by marriage as legal?
My personal position is that I would not support rolling back domestic partner legislation. And in fact, my personal position is that all of the practical problems of gay and lesbian couples can be solved without redefining marriage. And I think that that can be done, and in California, in fact, already has been done. In fact, if you look at the in re marriage cases, the judge basically said, okay, show me what are the remaining differences between domestic partnership and civil marriage when they were litigating the cases that led up to Prop 8, not Prop 8 itself. And the things on that list were not really too significant. There weren't really that many things left over as differences between civil marriage and domestic partnership law. So I think the practical problems can be solved and should be solved without redefining marriage, because I think there are some distinct things that matter a lot, and that's what the fight is over. I mean, domestic partnerships went through in California with very little opposition, which I think is quite striking.
I just want to ask you, because domestic partnership laws and et cetera, they allow for same-sex couples to be parents. So I just want to be clear that you don't have any objection to that. Is that correct?
I personally do object to that, okay? And my organization does not have a position on that, but I think that it's based on my objection to artificial reproductive technology more generally. Okay, that what we're doing to our children is that we're basically saying that that adults can decide in advance that you will never have a relationship with one of your parents.
So you don't actually support full legal equality through some domestic partnership or civil union. I just wanted to be clear.
No. My point is that is the difference between a same-sex couple and an opposite-sex couple that can only be bridged through artificial reproductive technology. And I think that is an injustice to the child. And to me, that issue of justice to the child is more important than what we're talking about, the remaining differences between same-sex and opposite-sex couples.
And that has nothing to do with civil marriage. It has nothing to do with extending and ending legal discrimination against gays and lesbians, the provision of civil marriage. What you were arguing about has nothing to do with civil marriage.
Let's take another question from the audience.
Mrs. Morse, our Constitution, both California and the federal Constitution, state that all men, and in quotes, women, are created equal. However, when Ms. McKay was talking about equality, you took exception and you said, I quote, equality is about who is equal to whom and for what reasons. So by that I take it that you think that not all persons are created equal, but that other people can decide for what reasons someone is equal or is not equal to other people.
Let me clarify what I'm saying there. I'm saying equality is conceptually not a standalone concept. That means equality means you have to figure out what's on either side of the equal sign. When we say all men are created equal, all women are created equal, that doesn't mean everybody has the same income. That doesn't mean everybody has the same IQ. Doesn't mean everybody has the same house. There's all kinds of things that are not encompassed within the statement, all people are created equal. So that's what the issue is, and that's the issue that deserves to be discussed, to simply use that phrase and say marriage equality obviously and straightforwardly implies that gender is not a factor in marriage. That doesn't follow. That is my point. That does not follow. That's a position that has to be argued for, and we should not be assuming. And I really take issue with the idea that you simply presume that anybody who doesn't agree with your interpretation of this issue hates you. That has nothing to do with it. It has to do with what we think gender's about, what we think sex is about, what we think marriage is about.
I was going to ask a question about the issue of homosexuality being an immutable trait, which if the courts determine it is, there's no way Prop 8 is going to stand. But I have a question for you, Jennifer, about, because you said earlier that homosexuality is not a choice. I stayed in the closet for 22 years out of fear, and I was not living in a right-wing Republican place. I was living in Berkeley, California. And the reason I did is because our society puts a value on marriage, on relationships, and on the future and the ambition to being able to get married and have children. And that was the phobia, the fear that of not being equal. If you do not believe that homosexuality is a choice, would you tell gay people that they should never have come out, that should they have gone through reparative therapy, and should they get into loveless marriages with women just so they can have the right to get married?
Well, no. Why would I say any of those things?
Because that's what you're implying.
Well, I don't think that's what I'm implying at all. And first of all, I think it's true. I totally believe that for you, homosexuality was not a choice. I totally believe that.
But you said it was. You said it was not a choice earlier.
Wait a minute.
You said it was a choice.
Let's slow down.
Please. I have no doubt that there are some people for whom homosexuality is an immutable trait. I have no doubt about that. But I also have no doubt there are some people whose sexual identity is fluid. I have no doubt about that too, okay? And so therefore, the question is, how are we even going to define this quality of homosexuality? How do we decide who counts as a gay person or a lesbian person, given that there is some fluidity in the trait? And by the way, it's very interesting to me, with the civil rights argument taking such a high priority in this discussion, that so many African Americans do not share the view that this is a civil right in the same way that the racial issue was a civil right. And I've talked to a lot of African Americans and said, what do you think of this argument? You know, why is it that 70% of African American voters in California voted
60.
Yes on Prop 8?
Yeah, that's not even
that's
true.
70,
that's
not
72.
True.
You guys, look. Ask them, why do they think this? Why did so many of them vote like this? And one of the things that I consistently hear from them is that in their view, there is a behavioral component to any definition of homosexuality that is simply not present.
Oh, so we're perverts? Is that what you're saying?
No. It says that there's behavior. That it's not simply something you're born with. There's also decisions about how to behave and in what context and all the rest of it. And so it's not a matter of you have to stay in the closet. That's not what we're saying at all. I don't think anybody's saying that.
I'm afraid we're out of time for any more questions from the audience, but I wanted to give either Terry or Molly a chance to respond for maybe 30 seconds.
Well, I just wanted to point out that there has been a campaign for not just the Prop 8 campaign, although it was included, but going all the way back to Anita Bryant, to really engage and draft the African-American preachers in the Baptist and other African-American churches into this campaign against gay people. And the notion of it not being equal and not being a similar situation is something that's been driven home for decades in the context of many black churches, because Jerry Falwell and others after him saw that as an opportunity. So I think if you ask some African Americans who may have voted in favor of Prop 8 why they did, I certainly asked some people how they voted and why they did, and they told me that their preacher told them he would lose his tax exemption, or that, you know, basically they were told it wasn't the same thing. And they're getting, you know, this is a marketing campaign, and it's a marketing campaign that got rolled out. That said, I don't think the numbers were anywhere near what people have quoted them to be. I think basically if you look at religious people, that marketing was done in white churches, in Hispanic churches, and it really was a church-based campaign. And so across the board, people who attend church really regularly, including African Americans, voted more heavily in favor of Prop 8 because they were marketed to by their preachers. And so that's why I think it came out that way.
And I also just note for the record that California NAACP filed an amicus brief in support of Marriage Equality USA, as has the president of the national NAACP come out and made numerous statements in support of marriage equality, and numerous civil rights leaders, including Coretta Scott King, etc. So this notion, is false. And I think what Terry points out is this being a distinction based upon what your religion is and what your misunderstanding of what was really at issue in Proposition 8 has much more to say about how you voted.
I'm afraid that's about all the time we have for our discussion, but we have something else here to end the program with, which Inforum does now, which is it's time to hear each panelist give us their 30-second idea to change the world. So we're going to ask each of the four of them in 30 seconds, and we'll be as strict as we can, what their world-changing idea is, whether it's on this topic or not. And why don't we just move down in order? We'll start with you, Molly McKay.
Well, I would think that we must see our common humanity in each other, that no matter what our political views are, that we really treat each other with dignity and with respect, and we listen to one another, because there is no distinction and separation. We are all human beings. We are all capable of love, and we need to be that love we want to see in the world.
Jennifer Morse?
My radical idea is that all children would grow up with their mothers and fathers who love one another and love them, and that they would have a right and entitlement to a relationship with both of their parents.
Therese Stewart?
I think my idea would be to have every heterosexual married couple get to know on a very deep personal level a gay married or partnered couple, depending on what's legal in their state, and get to know them beyond just the pleasantries of even sort of a nice neighbor, but really, really get to know what their families are about. And I think if that happens, people will begin to see that the similarities are much greater than the differences, and that treating us differently really doesn't serve any viable or sensible purpose.
And Kevin Snider.
I would have, mine's a little different. I would have a worldwide global moratorium on cell phones and emails, iPods, etc., for 1 week, and because we're so multitasking, it drowns out our own conscience and even the voice of God.
I think a lot of people might second that one. Let's thank our panelists, Molly McKay of Marriage Equality USA, Jennifer Morse, the Ruth Institute, the National Organization for Marriage, Therese Stewart, Chief Deputy City Attorney for San Francisco, and Kevin Snider, Chief Counsel of the Pacific Justice Institute. I'm Doug Sovern, and this meeting of Inforum in the Commonwealth Club is adjourned.